So, good morning. Monitoring a dual homed device with Zemix. Anyone tried it already? No? Well, let's see. My name, Brian van Bakel, working for Open Source IST Solutions, Zemix Consultant, Zemix Trainer. That's the only thing I do, actually. What are we going to look at? Simple network drawing. On the top, a Zemix server. On the bottom, a device. If this device is monitored with a Zemix agent, there is not a single issue. But let's just assume we are monitoring using SNMP. Just assume SNMP. So, the problem. Monitor the device in such a way that the monitoring is redundant. Sure, why not? Zemix server, fully redundant. Two interfaces per network. Two networks, completely separated, no routers, no connections, etc. And the device got a single interface per network. Sounds good. Seems to be working. Not an issue at all. We are monitoring over the blue network. And then suddenly, I don't know, the green network goes down. The cable breaks, the router goes down, switch breaks, whatever. Nothing happens. Monitoring is over the blue network. So it will just continue without any disruption. Still makes sense, right? Now the blue network goes down. Sure, blue network goes down. We've got a connection to the green network as well. But how to tell Zemix that it should be monitoring over the green network? Any ideas? Of course, we can create a second host. I mean, we create device number one with the IP address of the blue network, device number two with the IP address of the green network, and start monitoring it over both networks. But then you've got the data from two different devices, which are essentially the same device. Copying the item keys or copying the items? No, item key must be unique, so that will be a problem as well. And essentially, we've got no way of monitoring a setup like this, redundant, without any outage. So, how are we going to fix that? That's a good one. Let's stop monitoring using the IP addresses. Let's go for DNS. If we start using DNS entries instead of IP addresses, we can play around with DNS servers and some custom scripts and initiate a failover. Here's how it works. We've got a Zemix server and we've got a DNS server. Every single time the Zemix server is trying to pull an item, it will ask the DNS server what's the IP address of this DNS entry. Okay. Does it still make any sense? Sure. There we are. So, trying to monitor over the blue network, it will pull a single item. But before it knows how to reach to the device, it will ask the DNS server, what's the IP address of this DNS entry? It will get back an IP address and pull the device. So far, so good. And now, again, the blue network goes down. Still nothing happens. Zemix server will still reach out to the DNS server, get back the same IP address over the blue network. Nope, no failover. Unfortunately, we made the setup a bit more complicated with no result at all. We still have a network outage. Still monitoring is gone. Okay. Let's create a keep alive item. Let's tell Zemix pull this specific item every, I don't know, 10 seconds, 20 seconds, 30 seconds, once per minute, depends a little bit on what you want. And whenever no data is coming in, execute a script that is changing the DNS entries. That's essentially what we are going to do. So, DNS entry, well, if you use PowerDNS, there's a nice API, nice documented API, some Python script, parameters, blue IP address, green IP address, and well, make sure that the DNS entry is switched over. I'm not going too much into the detail, but well, I've got the scripts. If you are interested, just let me know. Cebix tries to monitor over the blue network. Network is down. Trigger goes into the problem state using a some sort of script. The DNS entry will be changed. If the DNS entry is changed, the next time Cebix is trying to reach out to the device, it got a different IP address returned by the DNS server. Hopefully the IP address of the green network, the green LAN. And suddenly, there was a failover. There we are. Still the blue network is down. But without any configuration differences, the Cebix server will reach out over the green network and monitor the device. Failover time around 5 or 6 seconds. Yeah, you can get it faster, but 5 or 6 seconds is feasible. Does it still make sense? Okay. Let's take a look at the DNS configuration then. We can create an A record just like this. Name within a zone IP address. Straightforward, right? Ask the IP address of a DNS record, get back the IP address, there we are. Or we can make a CNAME record. And then basically we point the DNS name to a different one, device 1 in this example. Why? Because this one is absolutely more complicated. It will work, but it is more complicated. Well, in the front end, if we use A records, we have to specify IP addresses in the front end of Cebix in order to give it as parameter to the script. It will work, sure, why not? User macro, IP address, another user macro, another IP address. There we are. With a CNAME record, we provide the CNAME or the different DNS records instead of IP addresses. That's the huge difference here. And here's the reason. With an A record, we can just see the IP address in the front end. Easy to understand, easy to configure, pretty straightforward. Not an issue at all. However, if you've got multiple environments, development and test, acceptance, production environment, try to migrate something from the development test to the acceptance and to the production environment, where probably all environments got different IP addresses. Good luck, have fun. I promise you, you will miss some IP addresses. You will migrate the host from the development environment into the acceptance environment and see that it will not work because, well, you forgot to change the IP address in the acceptance environment. Do the migration again from acceptance to production and you again have to think to change the IP addresses in the front end of Cebix. With one host, it will work. With 10 hosts, well, probably. Without many issues. What if you have 50 or 100 hosts? That's going to be annoying. If you start using CNAME records, you simply configure in the front end of Cebix, start using DNS record device.xiz. And that one is pointing to device 1 in the DNS server, or device 2 in the DNS server. You create a DNS server in an acceptance environment. You create a DNS server in a production environment and specify the IP addresses just once. With that setup, you are able to clone a host or migrate a host from an acceptance to a production environment without changing anything because the DNS server is completely static. It's aware of the IP addresses. You don't have to change anything. Yes, a bit harder to configure, a lot easier if you work with different environments. Depending a little bit on the environment, but I love to use the CNAME records. So, did we cover all problems then? Probably not. If you are using SNMP traps, and probably you are using it, you will see that the trap that comes in will have the original IP address. And then the Perl script within Zabbix is converting it so that the Zabbix server can pick it up. But it is converting it, specifying that the source is still the original IP address. Unfortunately, we do not have any interface that is pointing to that IP address. Nothing can be matched, and well, too bad, the trap won't be processed on the host. So we have to fix something there. How? Well, adjusting the default Perl script so that it is not using the source IP address, but capturing the source IP address, translating it into the DNS name, and then parsing it for the Zabbix server. Or create your own script. I love Python for these things. So in all my environments, there is a Python script that parses the received SNMP trap, capturing the source IP, changing it to the DNS name, and then parsing it back to the Zabbix server. Bit complicated, it still works. So eventually you will see, well, some sort of SNMP trap coming in with an original IP address, 192.0.2.10, which is translated into the DNS name. And the good part, if you go back, the DNS name is, well, stated in the host interface, so it will be matched on the host. And there you are, SNMP traps are working. So, a quick introduction on how to, well, work around these things. And again, a quick introduction. It took quite some time to figure this out. I did not go into any details too deep. If you're interested, well, find me. I think I can dream the script, actually. I've been playing so many times with it. So find me, ask whatever you want to ask. I'm pretty sure I can answer it. For now, are there any questions? Quite some questions, yeah. If it's working.
Yeah. Is there a specific reason for using two different networks and not just using a bundle or a trunk?
If you ask my opinion, no. There is no specific reason for it. However, there are quite a few customers that are bound to legacy networks. And if the customer was not that smart, you will find a setup like this. Unfortunately. So there's not really a good reason. It's more working around some legacy stuff. Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
I may be showing my ignorance here around Zabbix because it's all new to me.
Mm-hmm.
What would prevent us from just specifying two IPs for one A record? You won't need any scripts anymore, and you're done. Would that work?
Two IP addresses on one A record.
Yes.
That won't work.
Okay.
Because of the DNS configuration. I can show you the practical if you want, but trust me, for now, it won't work.
I have actually two questions. First of all, the two IP addresses. In the host definition, you can specify two times the SNMP interface. It usually takes the top one,
mm-hmm.
but if that's not available, it should perhaps use the second connection.
No, the issue here is that the item key should be unique per host, and you have to specify hard which interface to use. So, yeah, you can work around the problem by specifying two SNMP interfaces, but within minutes you will find that you got a duplicate item keys and it won't accept it.
Okay, that's good. A bit similar to your situation, monitoring a host that is both on running IP version 4 and IP version 6.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite similar, I think, the problems. Connecting the host to the DNS is fine,
mm-hmm.
and if IP4 is somehow not working on that host, but IP6 is, the connection still works.
Uh-huh.
using DNS. But again, you have the same issue with SNMP traps.
And yeah, I think exactly the same setup will work in that specific case.
Probably.
I haven't tested it, but I'm pretty sure it will work. Yeah.
Yeah, probably that's the solution. Exactly.
Yeah? Yeah. Well, let's discuss the issue afterwards and see if we can work around it.
Sure.
Pretty sure we will find something feasible.
Okay, thank you.
Any more questions? Nothing? Really? Am I the only one working with legacy networks then? Finding these stupid issues, trying to fix it? Damn. So, who got a job opening over here? I'm doing something wrong. Okay, well guys, that was it. Thank you.